Yeah, let's dive right in, buddy. Really awesome to see you. I know you're busy, so thank you for giving me this hour. Write down the time to make sure everything is proper. So yeah, man, I just filled out the Joyfully Uplifter application.
Cool.
Right. And, we just talked about it recently about the calendar, and you tell me mm-hmm. that it's full. So starting it, I mean, I remember back in Digital Jungle when we used to speak about Joyfully, and you were showing me your sort of like what you had, your prototype and something that was just getting started.
Yeah.
Very, very early on. You mm-hmm. were doing other things, and you were trying to run this mental health app, to help people with mental health problems.
Yeah.
So my first question is, what has been the biggest game changer for you in this last 2 years to take you to a place where now you don't even have room or there's not even something like the calendar's full for you guys?
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. Great question, man. And I just have to start off by saying, by the way, I'm just so glad to be on here. You've always been someone who I have an immense amount of respect for. So when I heard about the podcast and the opportunity to come on, I'm obviously overjoyed. It's a great privilege to be here. As far as kind of what the big breakthrough has been, or maybe like to your question, like what's the thing that's changed? A lot, right? But in the context of uplifters, and I know that during this conversation we will we'll kind of explain what that means, what an uplifter is, etc. But in that context, you know, what we've decided and we realize is that there's actually a lot of interest as far as folks who want to be uplifters from licensed coaches. So whether it's dating coaches or life coaches, etc. You know, there's so many of them, you know, hundreds of thousands in America alone. However, for new coaches and for coaches who haven't yet established themselves, one of their biggest challenges is, one, finding their voice and being comfortable speaking to different types of people, and two, finding people to talk to and getting that experience. So I've learned this, of course, through a lot of conversations that we've had, but we've begun onloading as uplifters a lot of coaches, and that's been one of the big breakthroughs from that perspective, from the side of, you know, the folks who are actually doing the uplifting. It's been that we've kind of figured out a way of solving their problem while also helping our users as well.
Got it. And just to get an overview of what Joyfully is, because this is the mm-hmm. main topic of today. Tell us about what is your journey towards giving a shit about mental health? Because not everyone does, right? You
yeah.
see people who only care about their bodies. You see people who only care about money,
yeah.
or people who only care about getting laid, right? There's a lot of different, and I've been in all of these different, buckets in my life. And so what sort of pushed you towards saying, you know what, I'm going to spend the rest of my life helping people solve their mental issues?
Wow. A lot there, man. So I would say it's definitely happened in stages for me, but the fact of the matter is, and just to even be quick to answer this one, I didn't care about mental health. I didn't care about my own mental health until I realized that I was in the middle of a mental health crisis of my own. So when I was, 25, I know we talk a lot about our affinity for New York City. My first job out of college and for the first 6 years of my working life, I lived in New York City. And for my first few years there, I was, working in the good job, right? At Bloomberg, major company in their headquarters, had like a, it was a competitive job, competitive industry, competitive city. And, I also had my own personal issues that I'd been dealing with. I had a friend in New Jersey who'd been murdered around this time in my early 20s. I had, other loss in my family. And it was just a lot of things happening at once. And I also was dealing with this imposter syndrome, believe it or not, not feeling like I really belonged in this environment. And then there were a lot of folks that worked at that company that were quick to tell me, hey, you don't belong here. You know, these are my colleagues who are basically trying to psych me out or something. And, you know, they're making it known through their actions and maybe just through their callous way of speaking to folks that they didn't think, you know, you fit in or something like this. So, through all these things kind of happening at the same time and just years of not even knowing what mental health was or what it was for me, it ultimately led with me needing to take a step back because I was starting to notice some things were happening, some changes were happening in my body. I was starting to have like a physical reaction to certain situations, whereas, you know, it really could have been just as simple as being able to take a step back, taking a deep breath, and, you know, decompressing. But I didn't know about those types of things, like mindfulness at the time. So to avoid myself from having like a nervous breakdown or something like this, I decided to take a sabbatical from work for about 7 weeks. I went down to Miami, Florida, spent time with my grandparents at the time. And that was, I would say, Farhan, the smartest decision that I made. Maybe one of the smartest decisions I've ever made. But certainly up until that point in my life, it was the smartest decision I'd made because I realized that I can't be my best self or provide for my family or be successful or make all these things happen unless I'm really taking care of myself first. And for me, that meant, you know, embracing my mental health and taking a step back, decompressing, coming back and being better than ever.
This is huge, bro. Yesterday, one of our friends, Mai, she's also at Digital Jungle. I don't know if you remember her. She always sat next to me, to my right.
Mai, she, yeah,
like long hair.
Of course.
You know Mai, yeah. Maite, yeah. Maite. Mm-hmm. So Maite is from New York, from Mexico City. Hmm. And she is in Mexico City today. She went for 10 days.
Cool.
And the reason she went, and it was very, really interesting because when I asked her, why are you going? She's like, I'm going as Patch Adams. And I was like, what? I mean, I've seen the movie, but what are you talking about? So apparently her family has this thing called a Patch Adams person, like a Patch Adams. And what that means is taking care of someone medically just by being there, like loving them, right? Wow. And like Patch Adams did. So she's like, look, you know, it's her mother-in-law is not feeling well. And she said, it's not something serious, but it's serious enough for me to go and be a Patch Adams for her. And they saw Patch Adams. It's the movie with Robin Williams. I don't know if you've seen it, but he's like a doctor and he's like, at the end, he's like shows his butt, you know, in scrubs, like he like moons the whole faculty. It's so funny. But his thesis was to cure a person, you have to give them love and affection and bond with them. And this is essentially, I mean, you know, obviously way better, but this is essentially what, if we're facing a mental health crisis, then this may be a part of it. So my next question is, you know, looking at what Mai is doing and also what you're doing and obviously what you did in Miami when you went with your grandparents, what is the contribution of love and friendship and social connection in mental health?
Yeah, I love that question. So essentially what I came to realize, one of the big insights that I had early on when it came to coming up with this idea, and of course I built a team where, you know, my head of operations is a licensed therapist. So she's trained, you know, master's degree in social work, top of her class and all that good stuff. Another collaborator we have, one of our advisors, she's a licensed therapist as well, PhD, you know, went to Spelman, has been working in psychology for over 10 years at this point. So I verify these things with them and talk through these things. It's the concept that, you know, loneliness, social isolation, just kind of being separate from folks who understand you, from folks who care to understand you, that actually has been found in numerous studies to be a precursor to depression, anxiety, and even issues like heart disease and lower life expectancy. There's a statistic or even a quote that was said from a doctor from Cigna, if I'm not mistaken, who said that loneliness is as dangerous as smoking 15 cigarettes a day on your physical health, right? So we all know that there is this mental and physical connection in general, but to hear it kind of said in that clear of a way kind of makes the point even clearer. So when it comes to what we do with Join Joyfully, whereas we connect uplifters to folks who are dealing with things like a breakup or doubting themselves, or, you know, maybe at work things aren't going the way they would like to, what we are able to do is to give them an empathetic ear and someone to give them words of encouragement that are tailored to what that person's actual experience is, which helps them to kind of hopefully preempt some of those issues that will take place longer down the timeline if you continue to not pay attention to your mental health and to what it is that you're dealing with. So that's the connection we found in the way that we help.
That's huge, man. And Mark, I don't know if you're familiar with Harry Harlow, but Harry Harlow is the psychologist. He's a Stanford trained guy. Hmm. He's not alive anymore, but awesome, awesome scientist. You remember Maslow's hierarchy of needs?
Of course.
Right? So Abraham Maslow was Harry Harlow's first graduate student.
Oh, wow.
That's the link. Mm-hmm. And so Harry studied at Stanford, and then he became a professor at University of Wisconsin. Mm. And he did the monkey experiments where he socially isolated the monkeys from their mothers for the first. So he would socially isolate a monkey, and I mean like solitary confinement. The monkey would not see humans, would not touch anyone, would not, like, nothing. The only thing the monkey had is sensory stimulation. So they, you know, had light, some white noise type stuff for the ears, you know, so it doesn't get deaf. And some other, you know, they could taste food. Obviously, they were eating food. But they were fed like literally solitary confinement people in prison.
Wow.
And what he found is like outstanding work, man, because, and I highly encourage you to read these papers and look at the videos on YouTube, because what Harry Harlow's thesis was is that we can study love through science. And no one in psychology believed this. They thought he was a mental, right? Because they're like, love, we don't talk about like that. We're scientists, right? We don't talk about love and all spirituality and bonding, and we don't do any of that. But what he wanted to show was, if you can prove that a monkey, and these are rhesus monkeys, who are isolated, and then what happens during the isolation and what happens after the isolation, right? So what he would do is he would isolate a monkey for either 3 months, 6 months, or a year. And then he would introduce them back into society, right? Either they would be, you know, reintroduced to their mother, right? Because they're usually separated like 3 hours after they're born. So they're very, very early. And then he wanted to see, hey, can I tie this fact of what I'm finding out in my experiments to actual human mothers and human beings? Why? Because in the 1950s, there was this concept, this theory that everyone believed, and that is, because of germs, it is best that mothers don't kiss their children. Wow. It's best that mothers don't hug their children. So in America, it was about, you know, two or three decades. The whenever a baby was in the hospital sick, the mother would only come once every 3 weeks to see the baby. It was unbelievable what was happening, and these babies were dying, right? And then they're like, I wonder why this is happening. Why are these babies dying all of a sudden? But then in the poor villages, or the poor cities or the poor hospitals, where they didn't have sterilization, they didn't have these like little chambers that they had built, which were like showcased in conferences. Those babies were taken care of by like the nurses were like hold the babies, and those babies weren't dying. They were fine. So they're like, what the hell is going on? So Harry Harlow, through some very unethical, evil experiments, he's the one who brought back to America this concept of, hey, you need to hug your baby. You need to take care of your baby. Don't just leave them crying because you want them to become tough or because you don't want them to be like soft. Because that was the theory back then, you know, 70 years ago.
Wow.
So my question is, based on this, And based on what you've already learned from Join Joyfully, is what role do parents play in mental health? And how can an uplifter somehow fulfill that role if it was missed?
I hope that we, I don't want to say if I hope we can replace that role, but you know, the fact of the matter is, you know, and I've learned this more and more over time that of course everyone has their own unique experience with their parents. Right. So for me to say something like, oh, I hope everyone, you know, has their parents in their lives or something like this. I want to make sure I'm taking into account that, you know, some folks really have a bad relationship with their parents. Not all parents are maybe even fit to be parents. Right. But I think that speaks a bit to the answer here. So I think, and it's interesting to hear you bring up that example of Harry Harlow, and I will be reading more about him after this conversation later today. You know, back in that time, in that era, right, 50s, 70s, all these decades here, you know, life was a lot harder, right? And I don't even mean harder as far as, you know, difficulty. I just mean the way that folks interacted with each other was very abrasive. At least I can say in the United States, right? From what I've understood from my parents and grandparents. So as a result of that, you know, a lot of folks, you know, maybe your parents, definitely my parents, and people of that generation, they don't really see mental health as an important, or they don't always see mental health as an important aspect of life. You know, how many of us have to, you know, put all the effort in to persuade our older relatives about the importance of going to therapy, right? Or the importance of talking about your emotions with folks. I know that, you know, my grandfather, he grew up in the Great Depression in Flint, Michigan. And, you know, from what I heard from my uncles and everything, he never said, I love you or anything like this during our whole time growing up. So now it's funny in the sense of, you know, we as the children kind of have to talk to our parents in a way about the importance of mental health. And so I think that even though they may not know, a parent may not know what mental health is, and I'm speaking for myself, as we become parents and as we raise children, it's definitely important to still show that same love, even if the vocabulary isn't necessarily there, to make sure that the kids can kind of, you know, feel appreciated, feel wanted, feel like they're valued. And these are all concepts that are important to mental health, even if you don't necessarily call them mental health. And then the second question was about how uplifters can kind of fill that void. So, or can address that. With our experience with Join Joyfully, the idea, and I know you got a chance to try it out, so I'd love to hear from you, but the idea is that we want to really make it a personalized experience. So we ask the user at the beginning in the onboarding flow, you know, what age range are you in, you know, gender identity, work experience, relationship status, et cetera. And then the important thing is we ask them about, you know, what led you here today? Kind of what's the issue that you would like to speak to someone about? And then we even give them the option. First off, there's around 50 different choices from there. But then we also take it a step further and say, hey, what do you want out of this, right? Do you want someone to ask you questions so that you can kind of think about things yourself? Do you want words of encouragement? You know, someone just to kind of uplift you and to speak those positive words to you? Or do you want someone to talk about their own experiences? So these are all different things that, you know, folks could, I suppose, get from a parent if their parent has the vocabulary, the know-how to open up and speak about things in these ways. But if not, then at least this opens up an opportunity for an emotional connection and a chance to connect with somebody who's been in your shoes before, being the uplifter. And then also to kind of set the terms as the user to say, what type of conversation am I looking to have here? You know, I've been in therapy situations before, and even just conversations that I've had with people where it's not really clear what the agenda is. You know, we're having this long conversation and I'm kind of like, you know, like, what's the point of this, right? Like, what am I supposed to gain out of this? It's not always that clear. So we try to make that clear up front.
Got it. Sometimes So before I ask you the question, just to tell you about the, again, Harry Harlow studies is just like so great.
Yeah.
What he did was when he separated monkeys, there was a subgroup which were mothers, right? So what he would do is he would separate, he would take a mother, like a girl who is not a mother yet, obviously, but at birth, he would separate this girl, right? In social isolation for 3 months, 6 months, or a year. Wow. And then he would bring her back into society. Now, what he found with these females is that they were not sexually responsive. They were sexually a bit retarded, like socially really retarded. And obviously, right? It makes sense because their brain has not been allowed to gain that experience of how to relate to the opposite, you know, gender, to have that sexual bond. And what he found is, so he wanted to see a mother who was socially isolated, what would happen to this mother, you know, monkey mother. But these girls were not sexually responsive. So he invented something called a rape rack. He called it a rape rack, where he would take these dominant alphas and he would have them rape these girls, these monkey girls, because they weren't sexually responsive, right? Regardless of if they were in their ovulation or not. And once they got raped, you know, they would have children. But here's what's interesting. They would not interact with their children like normal mothers do at all. But the children kept clinging on to the mothers. They kept clinging. They kept coming back. The mother would, you know, smack them. They kept coming back. Smack them, kept coming back. Not literal smack, but, you know, like in the monkey lingo. And what they found is that these children, monkeys, they call them psychiatrists. Because these monkeys were training their mother to become socially involved, to love, to bond. Because then when the mother had a second child, she'd be normal. She became normal. It's like unbelievable how even if we have been deprived socially for so long, we do have the ability to jump back. And we know this from the pandemic. Right? Like we were isolated for so long.
Oh, yeah.
And then the world seems okay again. Like the brain has this insane ability to rewire itself based on the environment. It's so cool. Yeah. So what I wanted to ask you is bringing science into this. So when we look at any therapist or someone who is licensed and it could be a psychoanalyst. It could be a cognitive behavior therapy specialist. It could be a Jungian, right? It could be any of them. But they have a certain training that enables them to give the proper feedback and the proper, you know, talk therapy. Now, an uplifter who joins and does get accepted, right? I want to know about that interview process. That call, which would, because a viewer may love to become an uplifter. So how does someone align themselves to this? Why would someone be fit for this?
Yeah. Great question. So first of all, I gotta be honest, Farhan, you definitely threw me off with the Harry Harlow example you gave there, man, with the monkeys and everything. Man, you said earlier that you know, he did these evil experiments and everything like this, and the points kind of connected for me as you were giving that example. sorry, but back to what we were talking about. The question is about, you know, what types of folks do we look for as uplifters, and then kind of what the interview process is. So it's changed over time. Initially, and it still applies. We look for folks who are empathetic, right? We look for folks who genuinely want to help other people. And oftentimes, and this is something that we always love to hear during the interview process, is when a prospective uplifter says something like, well, this is what I do anyway. This is what I do with my family, with my friends. And, you know, because I also kind of fit into that category. I've been an uplifter for years, right? Without even having a concept of what that actually even means. You know, and there's this whole concept of emotional labor and how fair is that? And we can talk about that as well if you'd like. But what we look for, again, is folks who have empathy and who genuinely are here to help others. And we have a series of, we have a five-step onboarding process. And we have a very long interview process where we ask a lot of questions to try to get to that point in a number of different ways through predominantly open-ended questions. Now, as far as with the interview process, the types of people we look for and the folks we've brought on folks who are, you know, Paralympians. One person was in the U.S. Special Olympic team for powerlifting. We have three different members of very popular documentary films, one of which is actually on Hulu and Disney Plus right now. We have folks on there who are, you know, guidance counselors at schools, drug counselors, folks who are in the church, you know, deacons and you know, folks like this. We don't discriminate as far as lived experience because we know that the users who are coming onto our app, some of them are going to want to talk about, you know, faith and spirituality. Some of them are going to want to talk to someone maybe about drugs or something like this. We don't necessarily force folks to go down one of those directions, but we want to make sure that we have uplifters that can speak to a variety of experiences. And that's one of the most important things that we're looking for during the interview process. And we'll be opening the interview slots up back soon. But right now people can still apply, but yeah, it's just, we just have, you know, a lot of folks on there and, you know, we have other things we have to focus on in the meantime.
Got it. Mark, jumping now to entrepreneurship, right? Yeah. From the first day I met you, man, I'm like, this guy is a smart motherfucker, right? Like, wow. like, cause you know, we got along from day one and it's,
oh yeah.
There's this energy of, even though you were at Bloomberg and are you still there? Or are you full-time join Joyfully?
Full-time on Joyfully. So at the time I met you, by the way, I was working at Match Group. So dating app, the big dating app company.
Right.
That's where I was working. Yeah.
Right. Exactly. So, stepping from the job 8 to 5, 9 to 5 deal to entrepreneurship, and I've seen lots of people who failed, and there's always like one or two, usually just one trait of a pure entrepreneur, someone who can like go all in and go deep into something that they truly believe in.
Yeah.
What was the tipping point, or what was the what was that little shock or something that you got which made you say, you know what? Nah, I think this is it. I'm going all in.
Yeah. Man, it's funny because growing up, I didn't know any entrepreneurs. You know, I know some folks are fortunate to maybe have parents or whatever folks in their community or something like this that own businesses and they can ask all these questions too. I didn't have that, but I wanted that, right? When I was 20, I used to own an ice cream truck. So I drove an ice cream truck around New Jersey. You know, when I was 21, I did like a business where I was helping folks, I was writing folks resumes for them and helping them prepare for job interviews. So it was like a job coaching type service I was doing for folks. I went to a community college. So a lot of the people I was dealing with were, you know, single parents or folks who their only work experience was in retail and they were trying to get into corporate America. And I was helping them kind of tailor and prepare themselves to realize that there actually are things that translate over to that. So I don't know. What's important for me has always been kind of like a mission of helping folks. And I know that with ice cream trucks, I guess you're helping people on a hot day, you're giving them some kind of refreshment. But when it came to the other things like the resume stuff, that you know, again, it was very clear that I was trying to help people there. So I just always had this sense of, you know, a desire to be of service to folks. You know, my mom's a teacher, been one for 27 years. My dad worked in nonprofits for a long time, and they just both always preached to me the importance of just looking out for people. And you know, that you never know what the person you're talking to is dealing with, you know, what they have going on in their life. They might have just lost somebody, even if they're yelling at you or being, you know, a jerk to you or something like this. They might have just been through something that you wouldn't even imagine or you couldn't even deal with yourself. So it's best to move with love. You know what I mean? And to treat people, even if you don't know them, to kind of treat them as if you love them, right? And you care about them, right? So I believe that with man, the work experiences I've had have definitely been different from that, right? I've definitely had worked with a lot of colleagues who I don't feel necessarily gained those same lessons growing up, let's say. But, you know, I think working at Match Group, where I was basically, I did a lot of user interviews there. So they didn't have like a very robust user research process at the time. User research meaning, you know, look, at the end of the day, people come onto dating apps because they're trying to meet somebody, right? Whatever their agenda is with meeting that person, regardless, they're looking to meet someone and have a connection, right? And the importance of, and what user research is actually speaking to those people or doing tests or just doing, gaining insights about those individuals when they come into your app. You know, what are they doing? What are they interested in? What are their motivations? What do they wish was there? What do they wish was not there, et cetera. So I played a big part for the department that I was in within Match Group of, you know, starting up that user research initiative. And man, Farhan, I was talking to folks from all different demographics, all different age groups, different ethnicities, et cetera. But the thing that I kept hearing from them was honestly the thing that I was expecting from the beginning, which is the mental health side of that lack of connection, right? The fact that a lack of connection has these implications on your mental health. I was talking to folks who were saying, you know, yeah, I'm really into painting, and there's just no way for me to put that out there on these dating apps. And as a result, nobody even knows this about me. And this is one of the most important things about me. So you're going through life, right? Having this hobby, having this passion, and, you know, the people who you deal with and the people who you want to deal with don't even know that about you. So it's almost like you've hidden that in a sense. They can't even be their full selves in a sense. That's how they felt. So for me, Farhan, it was just that feeling of, you know, there's a way for me to be of service here. There's a way for, you know, this idea that I've had, this insight, this experience that I've gained, to use this and actually to be of service to people who otherwise, you know, kind of don't feel like anybody's really paying attention to them or cares about them. So that was the big insight. And I knew I had to go big because, you know, I just believed in the problem, man. I believed in the problem. I believed in even a digital jungle, man. You know, I was doing user interviews there. I don't know if you remember this, but I might have even done one with you, man. Just I was like sitting down and asking folks about their experience with social isolation and their experience with, you know, kind of being separate and feeling understood. And I gained a lot of insights from there. And it just goes to show me, man, like whether you're traveling in a beautiful place like Tulum or you're a construction worker in Ohio somewhere, a lot of us, you know, we have the same problems, and I try to come up with a custom solution that will be personalized for everybody.
Got it. Mark. Yeah, man, thank you for your vulnerability. First of all, like you're, you know, answering everything honestly. And I really appreciate that because sometimes it's hard, especially when we dig into our own life, mm-hmm. to bring those thoughts back.
Yeah.
And with this concept, I want to ask you, because yeah. This happened to me a lot whenever I was doing a lot of coaching, mm-hmm. and have, you know, one-on-one or group coaching or doing client stuff. Mm-hmm. I don't know what it is about my personality, but I feel the pain that they're feeling,
yeah.
in such a way that it's really draining, mm-hmm. like, wow, draining. Mm-hmm. So when an uplifter comes on and let's say they have this enthusiasm and excitement to help people, and which is so awesome. Mm-hmm. Do you have anything in place where there is a sustainability? There's something that allows them to sustain the uplifting throughout their life, and not that, hey, the first three people I'm going to uplift this week, I do great, but then I drain myself. And then the last three have like this shitty thing. So what I'm asking is, how do you audit the uplifter?
Great question. And you touched on something very, very important to us. If my head of operations, Danielle, was on this call, she would, I know she would have a lot to say on this, because in our training, we actually have a module that's about that topic. I believe it's called like it's called burnout, but there's like a specific term for it. But yeah, it's just that idea of, you're taking in other people's energy, right? And then it can have that can impact you in a very real way. That's something that she, I don't want to put her out there, but that's something that a lot of therapists deal with. It's definitely difficult to circumnavigate. So when it comes to the point being in our training, we definitely deal with that, but we're always looking for new ways to address that. And we do, things like group calls among uplifters to let them speak to each other. And they can talk about, ways that they address that. We also look for uplifters that practice self-care. So that's one of the things that is really important for us in the screening process is, that they understand what self-care is and that they actually have a self-care practice that they themselves take part in. As far as auditing the uplifters, we everything is anonymous on the app. So I want to make sure I say that clearly. We don't collect, and you saw this yourself, we don't collect users' name or address or contact information necessarily. You create an account on the app, but that information is not shared with uplifters. So everything is, it's like you're private on this app, right? We deal now, where we're talking now with companies with, selling this as a perk to companies, right? We have a couple of big ones that we're very close with signing, and one of them we actually have the contract out. So it's just a matter of, we want to make sure that we're being of service, and also we want to make sure that we are being private. So being that we have folks on our team that are licensed therapists, they've been through the training. Also, we don't, our platform and what we do, it's not really under the guise of HIPAA, but we still follow and still have the same guidelines and the same data privacy protections that someone who was HIPAA compliant would have. So we go above and beyond in that regard. But certain members of our team, like one or two people, are able to look into the contents of the conversation to make sure that things are going well, if need be, because the user can flag if there's an issue, the uplifter can flag if there's an issue, and that would definitely prompt that. And even beyond that, the users are also able to indicate, hey, this is what I wanted. This is the kind of response I was hoping for, or, this is not what I was looking for. And then that also can be another prompt for folks to look into it to see what's happened. Those are the ways we audit. One is user initiated and the other is uplifter initiated.
Got it. I want to ask you, Mark, is there something that was truly unexpected for you in building this app? Mm-hmm. And you could think technically or people wise or strategically, or logistically, whatever that is. Was there any obstacle, or might still be a big obstacle? I want to know about like your biggest obstacle. What has hindered the progress the most? And it could also be something inside you, possibly. Anything that's like, this really gets in the way.
Yeah. I think that, I could talk about that for a while, right? I'm even curious about for you as well, but I think one thing for me personally, there's so much information out there as far as like, entrepreneurial stuff, what to do, what not to do. There's books, there's email newsletters, there's, websites and podcasts, all these different things, right? And I am someone who I like listening to interviews. I like listening to people, you know, to experts speak about their expertise, the things that they're experts in. So I think that for me, Farhan, honestly, it's just been really sifting through all the information that's out there, including we get, you know, we have data obviously internally, right? That's generated through the app, but it's kind of like, but more so what I'm speaking to here is all the external information, the experts and the things that they say you should do and shouldn't do, et cetera. And kind of figuring out, you know, what advice do I take and what advice do I leave? You know, what do they say? Separating the wheat from the chaff, right? Like kind of figuring out, you know, what are the insights that I should follow? And, you know, frankly, far on the way I deal with that is just by making sure that every day I'm making progress and doing something, right? I told you that I was up last night pretty late, you know, and I get up pretty, and I got up pretty early yesterday too, right? And today, you know, kind of the same thing. So making sure that I'm focusing on the right thing. There's this whole concept of the Pareto principle that I'm sure you're familiar with. You know, what is it? 80% of the results come from 20% of the work. So thinking smart about, you know, what are those key areas, the key things that we need to do that we can get the most learning from or get the most, the best business outcome from, and then figuring that out. And dude, honestly, if there's a shortcut for that, you know, I'm all ears, but I would definitely say that, yeah, man, just kind of filtering through all the information that's out there and then deciding like, what do we need to really act on? It's a challenge, man. It's a challenge for everybody. And I'm still working through it.
Good, good. Reminds me of that time when I was doing the push-ups outside Digital Jungle and you joined me.
Yeah.
it's a good stress reliever, the 100 push-ups challenge.
Oh, boy. Oh, man.
I want to ask you, Mark, about the difference, if any, between someone who... Imagine you were to do a physical health, body health app, right? Mm-hmm. Instead of a mental health. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you could have diet or exercise or so on and so forth, but mental health and physical health, they're so related. I mean, body mind is like, I mean, it's so related.
Absolutely.
So how do you balance your own physical health? Because I'm assuming that the mental health side is obviously none of us have it figured out, but talking with people, discussing things with experts, reading and watching, and obviously you have people on your team that are licensed. You may have this perspective of mental health, but then is there any little niche here or aspect of physical health that you must touch upon? Because I would guarantee or really, really believe that if someone does not have the right nutrition, does not have the right sleeping habits, does not have the right exercise and or just some exercise for God's sake, right? Yeah. It would be kind of difficult to have a good, you know, good mental health.
So,
how is there a balance? Because if you focus on this word mental health for join joyfully, then someone may get the idea that, okay, mental health, I love mental health, but then this person may not be fit or healthy at all physically.
Yeah.
So how do you balance that? How do you align that?
Yeah. So in the app, one of the things that we definitely have as one of the topics that uplifters are open to speaking about and also that users can filter down and speak about is definitely health and wellness, and like nutrition, you know, dieting, you know, that type of thing is definitely something that is in the app that users can speak about, but you know, we can definitely do more in that regard. There's definitely more that we can do there. But for me personally, because I think this is more of a question about me personally, I'm doing the 75 hard thing. I think you're probably familiar with that. You know, I know you'd be familiar with that. You're one person. I was like, I don't have to explain to Farhan what 75 hard is, whereas I have to explain to a lot of other people what it is. But yeah, man, I've been doing that. I'm actually done on Friday. So 2 days from now will be 75 days. I started on January 1st. So for me, I'm always trying to find better ways because of that mind-body connection that I realized when I was dealing with my own mental health struggles. I've been very intentional with trying to prioritize physical health because, look, man, like, you know, we're in this culture, in this world where, you know, we gotta make things happen, right? We gotta make money. We gotta, you know, be productive. And a lot of the times, dude, a big epiphany I had when I was working in New York is like, dude, you know, you have business or whatever, you have fitness, you have like, you know, family, you know, relationships, et cetera. Right. There's like five different categories, I think that are most important in most people's lives. But you can really only prioritize like one or two of them, right, on a given day, at least in my experience, right? Maybe other people have figured out some optimal way of addressing all of these things, but you know, it's like the five F's, right? It's like family, faith, friends, fun, and fitness. I might have missed, or in finances, might have got that mixed up a little bit. But point being, you know, fitness is something that I've noticed for myself has definitely kind of taken a backseat sometimes. And so doing things like 75 hard, where you have to work out, you know, twice a day, you have to eat healthy and everything like that, man, like that type of discipline and that kind of like regiment has been for me what's been useful for me being in now what is the best shape of my life, man. I might be able to have kept up with you on that push-up challenge if we can go back.
You look good, man. Oh, you look good. Man. We will very soon do that again when you come to Tulum or when I come to Mexico City.
Hey, yeah. More than welcome, bro. Love to.
Yeah, man. One thing, Mark, this is this thing about physical versus virtual. You know, mm-hmm. in person versus virtual. Right now we're speaking virtually. Your app is virtual.
Yeah.
How much of a, what would a person miss if they rely on bonding and connection virtually mm-hmm. versus physically? So someone who's in an environment where they may not have a community, like the painter you mm-hmm. told me about, right? Mm-hmm. A painter may not be in a city with art, like yeah. people who care about art, yeah. right? It may be like a very science oriented city or a math and engineering oriented city. Mm-hmm. So that person may be able to find someone on Join Joyfully to talk mm-hmm. about these topics. But how much are we missing here if we rely on apps? Because you said everything is private. So, you know, I was going to ask you, how can I meet my uplifter in person? Right, but I can't because it's private. Mm-hmm. So do you have any vision about how Join Joyfully could maybe one day allow people to meet in person and have communities that we can, you know, actually go hug people with?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Great question. Dude, it's funny, man. Maybe I'm jaded a little bit. I won't say jaded, but maybe this informs my view a little bit. But during my time at Match Group, you know, again, it's the biggest dating app company. They own Tinder and Hinge and Plenty of Fish and all these other dating apps. One of the things that was a big concern, and it's in the news, you know, you could see these news stories, is like, what happens when those meetings go wrong, right? You know, there's that whole concept of, you know, a man, like in a heteronormative situation, like, you know, a man and a woman go on a date. You know, the man's worried about the girl kind of like ignoring him or not laughing at his jokes, and the girl's worried about the guy physically doing something, right? You know, that so it's kind of this whole concept of like safety is really important, and that's something that we definitely do want to address when it comes to like maybe meeting up with uplifters in person or something like this. It's not something that we have thought about at this current time, but you know, if that's some feedback we get from users that, you know, that we need to start thinking in this direction, then obviously we're going to start thinking in that direction. Right. But to answer your question, Farhan, as far as what we do currently is, you know, a lot of folks, one of the most popular reasons actually that people come onto Join Joyfully is because, that social connection thing. They want advice when it comes to making friends, or they want to talk about making friends. And even on like platforms like Facebook, Reddit, you know, people are already coming to these online forums and trying to make friends online, right? Like they're already trying to make connections online. And that was, believe it or not, actually a big insight we gained when I was at Match Group as well from those user interviews, that one of the main things folks were looking for was companionship, even beyond just dating. Some, like, I think, I don't remember what the percentage was, but a large percentage of dating app users for the apps that we worked on were more interested in making friends than they were in finding a romantic partner. So what uplifters can do, again, because of their own lived experiences and or because of their trainings, if they're coaches, is they can speak about, you know, what they did when they moved to a new city, right? That's actually one of the big categories, you know, moving to a new city and trying to make friends.
Yeah. I saw that.
So uplifters can go on there and talk about that experience. So whether it's advice with, you know, going out there, or even advice, dude, here's something that's really been popular that we found out this week. Users are basically talking about like being anxious about getting out there. Like they're nervous about getting out there to talk to make friends, to go out there and kind of make connections in real life. I think a lot of that has to do with the pandemic. You know, if they come on here, they can kind of get some words of encouragement from an uplifter to say, hey, you know, how about this? Maybe tomorrow you go out and you just work from a cafe, or maybe tomorrow you go out and you know, talk to somebody about your art, or you try to show it to somebody on the street and see what they say. I don't know. You don't do something weird like that. But the point being, helping someone kind of build up that confidence to beat, and then also to have somebody at the end of the day when they come back home to talk to kind of cheer them on and to congratulate them. I think it's something that a lot of people need. Millions of people need that. One every three
encouragement,
Americans. Yeah, the encouragement, yeah. Man, dude. Yeah.
This is something Jordan Peterson talks about a lot in his podcast. He says, young men today, they just need encouragement and there's nobody to give them encouragement. Like literally a pat on the back, like, hey man, everything is good. Mm-hmm. Like I'm with you, I got you.
Yeah.
That's huge, man.
Sure.
Really good point. Mark, the last sort of concept, I want to get more philosophical and spiritual, because this has been very important for me, especially late. I wouldn't even say late, because I'm still early in the game, but probably like 7 or 8 years into my entrepreneurship journey, I learned something about myself. And that is, I was building something out of insecurity and fear rather than love. So sometimes what happens is we can build an empire. Michael Jordan did, Kobe Bryant did. I mean, a lot of people have done, but it's not out of this love inside, you know, the love for something. It may become love later, because, you know, if you do something over and over, you might just start liking it. It's like a confirmation bias, but it stems from a deep, I'm going to prove him wrong.
Yeah.
A deep, I'm going to get it. Mm-hmm. You know, there's this deep fear that allows, you know, our ego allows us to build this big thing out of fear. Right. And a lot of people say even like Mark Zuckerberg's Facebook is built out of his lack of social skills. And he was trying to build something to like find out if girls are single, because he couldn't ask them in person. Mm-hmm. So huge things can be built out of insecurity. So how do you let your love and the pure care of someone, how do you let that win over, hey, I have this problem? Because, you know, for me, I had low T in you know, back in my early 30s, I had low T. So I was like, you know what, fuck this. I'm gonna show them, and by them meaning me and like my previous self, and I'm gonna build something to improve my health, and I'm gonna stick it to him more, him being my ego, that I'm gonna help millions of people, right? But then when I look back 7 or 8 years later, I was like, wait, that wasn't even out of love. I did that shit. It's not even something that I'm naturally gifted at. It's like I learned stuff so I could overcome the insecurity of X, Y, and Z.
Yeah, yeah.
So how do you not let that happen?
Yeah, well, dude, I gotta ask you, is that a bad thing inherently? right?
I think so. I wouldn't say the word bad. I wouldn't say the word bad, but I can only speak for myself. Like this podcast, right? When I'm full-time podcaster now, right?
Oh, cool.
I told the Afro-D team that I'll make ads for you guys. You know, tell me when you need an ad. I'll help you with the ads because, you know, I've been doing this for a few years now. And I can help you with the high level strategy. All good. But when it comes to my time, I'm going to spend it reading, writing, podcasting.
Wow.
Like 99%.
Nice.
Because this is my blood. This is like what I did as a kid, right? It's not any insecurity. It is pure, awesome being in the present moment, right? So that I had to shift. And dude, there's a lot of fear in this, right? Yeah. Shifting, like, oh my God, are we going to go bankrupt? Like, are they going to be okay without me? Are my children going to be okay living on their own, right? But yeah, man, I came to terms. And they're running with it. They're doing amazing.
Wow. Dude, congratulations, Farhan. That's awesome. I got to say, I don't know if, I mean, all the podcast viewers here aren't going to know this part. But dude, I remember seeing you at Digital Jungle. And I'm not saying you do this every day, but you definitely watched a lot of like podcasts like Joe Rogan and stuff like that. And the fact that now you're able to do this full time, you know what I mean? I mean, you must be living in your dream right now, man. So I'm really happy for you.
Thank you, man.
Yeah, but sorry, to your question that you asked me, how to make it so that I'm being led by love and not by fear. Personally, man, I think it's a day-to-day thing, man. You know, I was raised, I'm a person of faith. You know, I was raised, you know, my faith is obviously very important to me. And so through that, I've always, and I even kind of alluded to this earlier, you know, I try to move with love, man. I towards everybody, you know, I try to go out of my way to show love to people in some senses. And now obviously I don't do that every day and, I definitely slip up, but, that's kind of just the way I try to live my life. The way I intend to live my life is to show others love, even if I'm not feeling happy by myself. Dude, then on the other side, man, like, I don't know, you talk about Jordan and Kobe, two of the greatest of all time. Like, you know, there's this book that I read called, Relentless.
I read it.
You read, oh, nice. I love that book.
Tim Grover. Yeah. Amazing. Tim Grover.
Exactly. Exactly. Great book, man.
The Cleaners. So,
like, yeah. The Cleaner. Exactly. The Closers, the Cleaners. So yeah, like for anybody who hasn't read that book, it's an amazing book, but, Tim Grover was Michael Jordan, Kobe Bryant, and Dwayne Wade's trainer, but he was like their physical trainer, but also their like mental trainer in a sense. He kind of got, I don't want to say got them into to have a certain mentality, but he definitely understood deeply how their mentality worked, like the Mamba mentality that Kobe Bryant had, right? So the book talks about kind of how you can fuel yourself with a lot of different things. You can fuel yourself with that dark side. It's kind of what that book talks about. Like, what's that dark thing within you? Let that fuel you, because that might be more powerful than fueling yourself with love, right? Again, point being, there's just different perspectives on this topic. But for me, I actually have a lot of post-it notes, man, around my workspace. And this is my answer to the question. I have post-it notes where I will actually write down the people who I'm doing this for, you know? So when it's like 1 a.m. and you're working and you're tired and you don't want to keep going, I literally will, I don't want to say anybody's name here, but I will literally have a post-it note of somebody who I care about or somebody who I just saw on the street who's going through a rough time or somebody who needs this, but I can't necessarily talk to them or someone who needs me, right, to be my best self so that I can help provide for them in the future. Those are the things that actually fuel me. And that's 100% out of love, believe me.
Wow. You know, Mark, I love that you're doing this because I never did this myself and I probably should have, because when we first started Afro-D, I remember it was in Bali. That was our first seminar. It was like 2018. And I knew there's 40 people who joined that first day on our webinar. And I knew every single one of those 40 people. I knew them personally, right? Because they'd been on their Facebook group and so on. But now, right now we have 50,000 customers and growing, right? Nice. So now it's like I don't know everybody.
Yeah.
So now, like, accidentally, when I get on Skype and, you know, we're getting calls all the time, right? And then, like, someone calls, I'm like, oh, fuck. Like, I don't want to pick up this phone call. Because now it's like, I'm busy and I got to do this. And now this person, I miss that this is a human heart here. This is a human being with problems and pain and love and friendship. And so I'm really happy, Mark, and keep doing that, buddy, because knowing who you're fighting for, and be it from a dark side or from love. And hey, those two could be equal, by the way. It doesn't have to be separate, right? Your love could be so deep that you are fueling it with your darkness, which is awesome. It's like Robert Greene territory here, right? So yeah, man, congrats for building that habit of the post-it notes. And because visually you're seeing that, okay, this person's life I'm helping, and I'm going to help this person's family grow and with more love and bonds and connection. So,
absolutely.
Congrats, man. And Mark, I just, you know, I know you have to go. So finally, just if someone wants to join as a user of Join Joyfully and get help in their mental health issues, you know, which is very, very multifaceted, or someone who also wants to help others and become an uplifter, how would they do that? How are they able to contact with you, get in touch with you and join joyfully?
So they can come, if you want to use our app, right now we're in a free research preview phase. So you can come on right now totally free and use the app. You go to joinjoyfully.com, and then right there at the, as soon as you get on, there's a big button that says get started. You can click there and and then kind of fill out a form and you'll get access to the app from there. Alternatively, if you like to be an uplifter or just to chat with me, you can follow us on Instagram at Join Joyfully. Same thing on Twitter as well. Yeah. Would love to connect with anybody who wants to talk about mental health or anything that seemed interesting today. And Farhan, you're the man, dude. Thank you for having me on here.
Beautiful, man. Thank you, Mark, for taking time out of your busy day. I know you stayed up last night, and thank you so much, buddy. I look forward to a round two in the future, and definitely, we'll catch up again. And dude, bravo, man. Bottom of my heart. Thank you, buddy.
Absolutely, brother. All right, man. Take care. Thanks, Farhan. Bye.